more so it's like the latter half of season one, first half of season two, all of season three. Once Five kills all of the board members in season two, the show really kind of does a bit nosedive. With, what's it called? With Umbrella Academy, with season one, it really took a bit for it to kick off. Like, the second time I watched it, I kind of realized that first season, at least the first three episodes, kind of, they don't really get to where level of love for Umbrella comes to. Like, once we get to like, the days that never happened, and the days that did happen, that's it. I'm into that show rest of the way through.
Yeah, and you know me, majority of what drives me with these shows is the villain, right? And I didn't think Leonard was all that great in season one.
Oh, no, terrible.
In season two, it's like the Swedes and the Handler, which I thought was a bit better. But I think a second raising of Hargreaves' children as the villains is such a funny and kind of just poignant a set of villains in this. And we're going to get hot and heavy into the spoilers. But before we do that, we wanted to give those who haven't seen the show an opportunity to hear our thoughts about, you know, a bit of a spoiler-free review. So I'll go ahead and I'll start and I'll give my opinions and keep it as spoiler-free as possible. I thought this season was a lot of fun. This show shows the best of ensemble ensemble projects, whatever you want to call that. We're seeing a group of individuals, actors, who have become familiar with not only themselves, but their interactions with other actors playing those characters. Everyone feels lived in, finally. Everyone feels like their character, and they know it to the T, and the inflections, all that stuff. It's like you said, when the show starts up again, and it's really easy to fall right back in because, one, you're falling right back in from a cliffhanger from season two, and secondly, they know their characters so well that it fits like a glove. It's crazy, I'll say on the offset, it's crazy to me that these actors aren't doing more. I like the fact that Klaus, I think it's Robert Sheehan, the fact that he's not in more things, like I'm watching the man act and I'm like trying to cast him. I'm like, he's got like a Nightcrawler build. I wonder if he could do a German accent. You know, Klaus still my favorite. I have a secret MVP that I'll save for spoilers. Somebody who freaking jumped past the rankings. And somebody who's always been dead last and finds a way to stay dead last in this season. And I've already seen some online chatter that they're not very happy with a certain character's stuff. And we're here to talk about all of that. We're here to chop up all that stuff, which we liked, what we didn't. And it's not, you know, just because I hated something, you might have loved it and vice versa. But that's what I think this show is great at. There's so many different aspects of this show that anyone can find something to like, one character to hold on to, one story thread to follow through, and it keeps you interested throughout. Where I felt like, for the most part, they couldn't direct the traffic well in the first season. Like, if one person was doing something, we followed them for the whole episode because we didn't have time to direct the traffic. In this season, it felt very directed, very well paced.
Oh no, it went like it knew where it had to go and how it had to be, and it didn't stop for one second.
Yeah, I could argue that there's a mystery that gets solved about, I would say, the third or fourth episode. It exists in episode one, but it doesn't get resolved until about the fourth episode. And while that probably could have been sped up a bit, the time that we took to establish the other things in the series, like meeting characters, finding out motivations, and putting the pieces on the board, that when we found out what was actually going on, things went off. Like, at one point I'm watching the show and I'm like, I totally don't have to finish this now. Like, I have time to finish it for the podcast, but I'm in it. I'm knee deep. I want to know what happens next. And so I was able to finish it all on Friday for the most part, which was fun. But in my opinion,
I think
Wednesday.
Yeah, it came out Wednesday. That's right. It came out Wednesday, and I threw it on at 6 o'clock in the afternoon, and I didn't finish till around like 3-4 o'clock in the morning. I did the whole fucking, I couldn't stop. Even when I wanted to stop, I stopped for about 5 minutes, smoked a cigarette, watched a reaction on YouTube to something else, and I'm like, I don't even want to watch this reaction. I put out the cigarette. I went back to my bed. I'm like, no, I want to just continue watching this. This is too good, because finally we have a bad guy. It's not even a bad guy. It's just a temporal vortex. It's just a paradoxical anomaly that's just destroying all of reality.
Right. I mean, this family just can't seem to get rid of apocalypses.
Apocalypse.
In my opinion, I think the show is totally worth it. If you're watching, or even if you're listening to this, I'm assuming you've watched the first two seasons. If you were like me and you felt season two was lacking a bit, I think this is a return to form. If you thought season two was great, this may not hit those highs, but it is serviceable. It is definitely a serviceable chapter. And I like where everyone is now on the board. Whereas before, it was still up in the air. That cliffhanger for season two is big, and it kind of gets resolved a bit quickly. And like I said, we're keeping it spoiler free, but they knew where they were doing. And the last thing that I'll say is that one of the things that I think shows in this is that the showrunner says that they kind of want to close the book on this at season four. And you can almost feel that certain people are reaching the ends of their arc, or
when it came to the end of it, I'm like, there's at least three characters that don't have to come back next season.
Yeah.
Like, at least three characters can just go.
100%.
And you wouldn't miss them. I mean, you would miss them, but it wouldn't be missed within the conclusion of that story.
Right. And we've talked off air that these things don't have to go on forever. You know, if you can tell a tight story, if you can send a message, if all of that can be encapsulated in a short amount of time, then get that done. But I highly recommend it. Can you give your spoiler-free review for the people who might be on the fence about turning into Umbrella Academy Season 3? Why should they put this in as a priority in front of everything else that is out right now?
Because it has the best parts of The Boys and the best parts of Doom Patrol, and it does all of their faults better, especially Doom Patrol. And I love Doom Patrol with all of my heart. But there was a lot of faults in season three, and this season had no faults, like, at all. I could not think of one arc, one moment that didn't seem like it made sense to the story. Like, whether or not I hated the decision, it still made sense to the story. There was nothing here that was like, oh, this makes no sense. Like, there was so many reveals, so many plot twists and turns, characters that finally got to shine. Albeit different universes, but finally got to shine.
Yeah.
We basically waited 4 years for a lot of these characters to be what they were meant to be.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think the show has gained a lot of good faith. It's done a lot of good in the past two seasons that even the parts, like you said, that would be a bit frustrating, you're willing to go along with because you know these people, you know these characters. And so it's a lot easier to deal with their imperfections, but we are all imperfect as people. So it's almost, like you said, it becomes a character study at points. And I guess that's what the show kind of wrestles with. It wrestles with being narrative driven and being a character study. And I guess you can't be narrative driven unless you pick one narrative to kind of drive, right? And then everybody else is kind of in the back seat. And when you have an ensemble like this, like when the credits roll, Elliot Page is up front and center. They are the headliner of this. And like I said, again, I didn't realize there was so many actors in this with that haven't had as much big screen experience as Elliot. But now moving forward, it's hard to argue that a lot of these people are ready for the big time, man. A lot of these people here are ready for for prime time. And I think that a season four, a tightly written season four without COVID restrictions, without any hoopla, I think could really, you can put a bow on what could possibly go down as a perfect series of television.
If they can do season four right, and I have all the faith in the world that they could. And so I don't want to say that there's a possibility that they can't. I mean, there is a possibility that they can go down. You know, a lot of good shows did it that way. But like, you know, Breaking Bad, Leftovers, these shows put a nice little knot on their show. And I want Umbrella Academy to be up there.
Yeah. And I think it's different enough from the Gerard Way stuff. That you could enjoy both independently. I don't think the show spits in the face of the source material. It's hard for me to say that the show is three-dimensional because I don't think that the comic is two-dimensional, but I do think that the show takes its depths a bit deeper than the comic did. It's in the same way that we talk about off air with The Boys.
Well, 100%, but that was the thing, is the comics was more of like a young adult goth superhero genre.
Yes.
Like these characters were drawn. They were all drawn like a milky gray blue.
Yeah. But sickly. And they were drawn like caricatures, a lot of them, not like actual people, which is why Space Boy works better in the comic than he does in the show.